Let us think of a research situation where Asmita, she is a researcher in a chemical laboratory. She is conducting research with the various medicines and their effect on the patients, whether it is helping in curing the disease and so on. We take another example of Nita, who is a school teacher. She is teaching class 4. She is using various methodologies. While teaching geography, she notices that the students, they are finding difficulties in identifying various cities on the maps. So, she feels that she being the teacher, she should take some action for removing this difficulty. But how would she know whether the action has been successful or otherwise? So, she of course, she has the initial data of how the students are facing problems, how they are making mistakes. She designs a plan for them. She designs some teaching sessions, some practice sessions for them, and she have them implemented on the students. After the implementation is over, she collects the, once again she observes the students, and then she notes that the action plan, the session, the teaching session which she had designed had its impact. Now, when we compare both these situations, the first situation was a laboratory situation where Asmita was trying to work, whereas the other situation where Nita was working was a situation in the social life, in a daily life, a very, very classroom situation. Both of them are researchers, but then what is the difference between their research? In the first case, Asmita, who is her total focus or total maybe job profile is that of a researcher. So, all the time what she would be doing is just research, research and research. The situation would be much controlled as it is a laboratory situation. So, she would be deciding on which chemicals to take, in what proportion, then she has exact control over the time duration that has to be taken in during the research. As against this, if we see Nita's situation, Nita is working in the classroom situation, in the social situation, social life, so and working with the human beings. She is trying to solve the problem which she is facing in the daily teaching, daily life. Whereas Asmita is trying to solve the problem which may be not her personal problem or may not be her own professional problem, but it is a problem which has a larger implication to the larger society across even the countries maybe. In case of Nita, she is trying to solve the problem which has implication only for her situation, and she is working towards it just because she wants to solve her problem, makes the situation better. Now, so in this we can see that both of them, there is a component of research, yes, but the basic premise or basic reason for which the research has been undertaken is very much different. The second case in which Nita is trying to solve a problem, trying to study whether her solution is working out or otherwise, that is something related to her situation and her problem only. So, it is something called as action research. Now, as the word suggests, there are two clear-cut words in the term action and research. So, as the title very well depicts, it necessarily calls for two different aspects. One is action and another is research. So, a person who has the problems in the daily situation or the person who wants to solve the problem from daily situation takes up something like action research. So the person works towards improving the situation, the person works towards removal of the problem, removal of the lacuna, and that is something which comes under the purview of action. And whether the action is successful, to what extent it was successful, and what further improvements are required in the action plan, all this aspect is studied in something that is called that comes under the term research. Thus, the action research has both the dimensions: one is of action, and another is of the research. Action research is a easy and natural way of acting and researching together. When did this terminology action research came into picture? Kurt Lewin in 1940 first used this terminology. He is also called as the father of action research, and his thinking or the philosophical background behind using this terminology was, he was basically a person working into the social research, and he would say that this kind of a laboratory research has very little to do maybe with the daily life, especially when it comes to the social situations and sociology. So it is something also maybe the grassroots people do not feel that, it is also that the people at the grassroots level do not feel that what happens in the laboratory research has something to do with them. They are all the time busy acting, maybe improving the situation, dealing with the social situations, dealing with the problems, dealing with people. So his claim was there should be some modality in which these grassroots people or the persons who are acting or actually working towards improving the situation, they also should become researcher, and researcher should not remain in something that is ivory tower, and even they should be able to do research. And in fact, the research which they conduct and findings from that would make more sense and more usability for the people who are in the field. So he started with the concept of action research, and he basically talked about the four steps of he considered action research as a cyclic process and the four steps in that cycle. Kurt Lewin has defined action research as a comparative research on the conditions and effects of various forms of social action and research leading to social action. Using a process of a spiral of steps, each of which is composed of a circle of planning, action, fact finding about the result of the action. From the definition of Kurt Lewin, we can see there are four clear cut steps in the cyclic process of action research. They are plan, act, observe, and reflect. So, as the initial step, the action researcher plans the action that is to be conducted with the group or with the person. All the details are worked out in terms of exact actual strategies, in terms of timeline, maybe in terms of the resource material that is to be used. After this planning is done, then the same planning is implemented. So that is the step of action. So after plan, it's act. So the action researcher actually implements that plan with the group. Now this is a very crucial process, and the researcher maintains detailed observations during the conduction of the action plan. So these observations are not only during the process but even at the end of the process. So it is formative as well as summative kind of observations. So after planning, action, and then observation comes. All these observation in terms of how the group is reacting to it, whether the group is liking it or otherwise, how the group is responding, whether there is an improvement, whether there are any lacunas in terms of the action plan, or maybe lacuna in terms of conduction of the action plan and things like that are definitely detailed notes of these observations are maintained. After the observation, then there is the fourth step of reflection that comes, which is the last step in that particular cycle. So, during the step of reflection, the action researcher reflects upon whether the action plan, to what extent was it successful. If it is not successful 100%, then what could be the reasons for not being successful to the 100th point. To what extent are the group members responsible for it? To what extent is the action plan itself responsible, and to what extent the actual the person who is implementing the plan, maybe if it is a classroom situation, the teacher involved, how far the teacher is responsible for it, and which are the exact points of improvement for further action. So, through this reflection, the action researcher comes to know about where exactly the improvements are to be made, where exactly the plan needs to be changed. Now, this is the fourth and the last step of first cycle of action research. So, we started from planning, action, observation, and then reflection. After the, as a result of this reflection of the first cycle, that gives birth to the planning of the second cycle of action research. So, there are certain lacunas if during the first cycle, then through the reflection these lacunas are emerged, or maybe they are strike to the action researcher. So, the action researcher takes these threads and then builds upon his further plan of action, for which is more focused on those areas where the students were not so much successful, or maybe the problem was not so much removed. So, the person moves again once again to the action plan. But there is a difference between the action plan that was designed for the first cycle of action research, and now the person is working towards the second cycle of action research. But the cycle, the steps once again remain the same. Improved plan of action is prepared, then again that is implemented. So, act again, once again the observations are made on the improved plan, and the reflections are done on the basis of that cycle and action. Now, this is once again, as you see, it is a spiral, that it is a circular process, it is a cyclic process, yes, but it does not remain at the same level or same plane. As if one cycle is over and then the person moves from reflection to action again, that is the beginning of the next level, next step, or next journey in the for improvement of the situation. And thus it becomes a cyclic process. It is like you must have seen the spring in the ball pen. So, it is something like that, how one when one cycle gets completed in a spring, then the person has already reached the that small 2 millimeter distance, say, and then the second cycle commences, and then the third, and so on. So, this cycles of action research go on getting developed, and they are implemented till the problem is completely removed, till the situation is completely improved. It is the best situation that the researcher might have thought in the beginning. So, this is the whole cyclic process, and action research is always considered in terms of this cyclic process. In this cyclic process of action research, planning, action, and observation, they are very much familiar to the lay persons, or even for the other type of researchers. But the unique characteristic of action research is the step of reflection. So, let us discuss a little more about this concept of reflection and how it makes action research a unique method of research. Now, when let us first try to understand the nature of reflection. What happens in the reflection? So, as a beginning, in the reflection, when the person starts reflecting, one starts actually remembering what exactly happened during that situation. So, a teacher uses a particular strategy in the classroom. So, to begin with the reflection on this strategy later on, the first step that the teacher would go about is remembering how exactly the strategy was implemented in the classroom, how the students have reacted and how exactly the process went on. The next step from that would be what is it at the level of feelings when one tries to recollect what has exactly happened. Now, these feelings would be for both the receivers, that is the supposed students in this case, and the teacher. So, the action researcher as well as for the group. So, how did the students felt about it, whether they were happy, whether they were irritated, whether they were finding it simple, interesting and so on. Say at the same time, whether the teacher found it feasible, whether it was enriching experience for the teacher as well, whether he was or she was getting the feeling of the problem is gradually getting removed and so on. So, as a next step, the teacher or the action researcher would deal about the feelings aspect of the whole episode. The third level or the third step the action researcher would go is one would start evaluating these feelings. Okay, if the students have enjoyed, then maybe it is something indicating towards the success. If at certain points the students were confused or were irritated, not happy about, then maybe those were certain aspects where the action plan was not so successful, and maybe these are the areas where the teacher would like to improve upon the action plan during the next cycle of the action research. Similarly, one would also evaluate the one's own, that is in this case teacher's own feelings, whether it was how simple it was, whether it was feasible to attend so many students during that time slot. If I am saying that there was a problem and if I want to improve that problem, then is this really going to help, or do I need to even work on this point, that is the teacher's role in the action plan and so on. So, thus the process of reflection goes through these three processes. So, all this will form a part of the technical reflection. After that, the next level would come as a practical. So, it is the practical reflection. In this case or at this level, the action researcher would think about whether what was decided, was it practical? So, if 15 minutes were given, was it really sufficient, or is more time needed, or is whether it was an excess time and things like that. So, the action researcher would reflect upon these aspects of the action plan. And the last level, that is the critical reflection level, in fact that is the level the action researcher should and would gradually reach that stage. At the level of critical reflection, then it is all the more wider perspective is taken. And not the smaller components of the action plan, but the whole action plan is considered in totality. And the main reason for which this action research is undertaken in order to remove the problem, in order to overcome the lacuna, whether this whole action plan is helping in or whether the whole action plan is marching in that direction. Though Kurt Levin initiated the concept of action research and he is called the father of action research, there are many social scientists and action researchers who have contributed in making this concept popular, and they have added a lot of dimensions to this, the concept of action research. Let us see some of them. So, after the Kurt Lewin, it was Stephen Corey in 1950 who has contributed, and then there were many like him, like Lawrence Stenhouse, Carr and Chemis, John Elliott, Donald Scon, Jack Whitehead, and the latest one is the Gene McNiff. All of them have contributed in making this concept of action research more familiar to the people who are working at the ground level or grassroots level. They have also added lot of dimensions and added more clarity to the concept which earlier was generated by Kurt Lewin. So, we will now see how the latest version that is given by John McNiff, how he looks at action research. According to John McNiff, action research is a particular way of researching one's own learning. He believes in this, that it is when one conducts action research, one not only improves the situation, but also it is one's own learning. So, the action researcher, before action research and after action research, these two are completely two different persons in terms of his intellectual and emotional development, and maybe even sensitivity to the problems. So, he talks about the action getting conducted and then evaluating the action in terms of actual outputs. So, John McNiff talks about collecting the evidences to prove that yes, the situation was improved and the problem was removed. Gene McNiff and Whitehead, both of them have worked together and developed set of questions which a common person or a person at the grassroots level, actually the person who is actually working, would ask himself or herself while conducting the action research. Let us see which are those questions. So, the list begins like, what is my concern? So, what is the problem that I want to solve? Why am I concerned? Why is this problem important for me? What do I think I can do about this situation? Because he is not a green room researcher, but he is actually the doer. So, the focus is on doing. So, what do I do so that this situation is improved? What will I do? So, if a person has come up with say 10 options, then which of the 10 options is the best one in this situation that is selected? How will I show whether I am influencing the situation for good? So, what are the evidences that are to be collected in order to check whether the situation has been improved? How will I produce evidence of my influence? So, I can see there may be certain factors which cannot be seen or captured. But then, when it comes to producing evidences, it will be something related to capturing these evidences so that even others can see. So, how do I produce these evidences? The next one is, how will I ensure that any claims I make are reasonably fair and accurate? So, maybe it is here, it is more than the just his own gut feeling. Even the others should be able to recognize, and they should be also able to accept that yes, there was a change and there was an improvement. And what will I do then? So, this once again calls for the second cycle of action research. So, as we have seen in this through these questions, it is nothing very much different than the basic model of cyclic process of action research. It is just operationalizing those steps, that is plan, act, observe and reflect. All these questions are linked to each of these stages, and it takes the researcher from the step of planning to finally the reflection, and thus the process continues in the cyclic manner. We will see a few more definitions of action research, through which we will come to know about some more attributes about action research. Action research is any research into practice undertaken by those involved in that practice It is therefore a procedure that the practitioner takes up. So, here the attribute of a practitioner taking up a research for the improvement of the situation is focus. We will see one more definition. Action research is a participatory democratic process concerned with developing practical knowing in the pursuit of worthwhile human purposes grounded in the participatory worldview which we believe is emerging in this historical moment. Now, here the focus is on participation. This participation is from both the sides, on the side of the person who is at a grassroots level, say suppose a teacher, and also on the part of the students with whom the teacher would be working. So, both the persons or both the groups, both the entities are involved in when it comes to conducting an action plan and then further the action research. We will see one more definition of action research. In this definition, the teaching learning situation is under focus. So, it has more implication for the school situation or a educational situation. So, let us see. Action research is inquiry based research conducted by teachers that follows a process of examining existing practices, implementing new practices and evaluating the results, leading to an improvement cycle that benefits both the students and the teachers. So, as we have already talked that the reflection not only is about the improvement of the students, but it is also about improvement of the teacher or the action researcher. This definition focuses on that aspect. It is not only there is a change in the students, but it is also it also brings the changes in the action researcher or the teacher. So, the action researcher definitely it is, so the process of action research is certainly a process of self development or a professional development. Action research is thus a scientific process of finding out solution for the current problems, and it puts the practitioner at such a high level in terms of research that if it is my situation and my problem, then only I am the best person to find out the solution and even to judge the solution. So, it is something like suppose a baby is crying, then the mother would be the best person to know what the problem is and take the action accordingly. It's the exactly parallel situation in when it comes to action research. Because when the action researcher accepts it as it is my situation, it is my problem, it is something related to the work that I am doing. So, he or she kind of owns it and even owns the problem in the process. And that's why it is all the more attachment with the problem and then with the solution as well. And only because of this process, the action researcher feels that yes, it is I have implemented with this solution and let me check whether to what extent it is successful, because I am not answerable to anybody else, but it is for my own interest and because it is through my own feeling that yes, I want to do something that I have taken up this action and then later on the research. And thus it definitely gives rise to the further improvement in that action researcher through reflection. Because if it is I have to address somebody else's problem, then maybe I will be just sitting on the bank of the river and guiding somebody else. Here that is not the situation. As they call that, if you want to, there is no, as they say, that there is no point in saying that the river is dirty, but if you feel the river is dirty, you better get into the river and clean it. So, the action researcher definitely believes in something like this and then doesn't hesitate to take the action and doesn't even hesitate to take the responsibility of the failure, because he knows that the second cycle of the action research would begin and the situation will someday or the other will improve, and one is also ready to put in those efforts, giving those inputs for improvement of the situation. In the action research, the practitioner takes up the research in order to solve his or her own problem. So, as against the other types of researches, this type of research, that is the action research, does not develop the fund of knowledge or does not develop, say, theories or principles that has a wider applicability for the rest of the world.